As we gingerly fist pump the air that we're finally coming out of the other side of the pandemic, one fact remains constant, that life goes on and time and tide wait for no one. We all have choices to make, and there is a landslide of evidence which states those citizens who seek a university education become drivers rather than passengers in the pursuit of a career with progression. However, which university and which course can often seem a complex conundrum. Lewis Carroll once wrote, if you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there. My name is Derek Watson, Associate Professor based at our Sunderland UK campus. To help you make the right choice, the University of Sunderland would like to share some truths about why we believe we are the preferred choice of destination. That is, if you want to find out who you really are, immerse yourself in a learning environment, which is more about you and how to secure that career with progression. Put simply, teaching beyond the textbook. To discuss these themes, we have a panel of experts eager to field your questions and share their advice. We have Lee Hall, Head of School of Media and Communication. We have Dave Napton, Principal Lecturer from the Faculty of Technology. Ahmad Hussain, MA Marketing Student on Placement at the University of Sunderland. And Drew Dalton, Senior Lecturer in Sociology. So panel, welcome to today's session on why we should choose the University of Sunderland. And for all those students that want to ask additional questions, please click on the tap profile and one of our ambassadors will help answer your questions. We do have a laundry list of questions and I'm going to start off with the first one. And the question is, why should an international student come to the University of Sunderland to study? Lee, could you open that question up, please?
Absolutely. Thanks very much, Derek, and welcome to everyone who's tuning into this. It's fantastic to meet our potential students, as always. I think Sunderland and the UK, massively attractive place for international students to come and study. Few things I would highlight. Firstly, generally the UK university sector is respected around the world. So you're coming to study in a country where higher education is hugely respected. And that's very, very important to make sure that you've got qualifications when you are done that are tradable, if you like, around the world. Everyone recognises the degrees that you're going to get from us. I think also at Sunderland and in the UK, you are open to sort of bursary support, financial assistance that you don't get in all other places. And actually, a lot of our programmes are much quicker to complete than in other parts of the world. So undergraduate programmes and postgraduate qualifications can be a little bit quicker. But I think the main thing for me is the culture. So if you come to Sunderland, it's an incredibly welcoming place. It's a place where there's lots of other international students. So you're going to mix with and meet people from all corners of the world, possibly some people that are from very close to home, and experience Sunderland and the UK's fantastic cultural experience and all that has to offer. There's so much going on, so many things to do in your spare time outside of education. It's just a fantastic place to have a great experience and get a high quality qualification.
Lee, I couldn't agree more when you talked about the culture. I think that is one of the unique selling points of our university. We have a huge connection with our student community and the academic and also all the support staff, focusing predominantly on students getting that rich education and, as I said in the introduction, careers with progression on a truly global scale. Ahmed, now you're a student currently studying at the university, but you're on placement. Could you develop that answer as well? Why should an international student come to the University of Sunderland?
To be honest with you, Lee probably like said it whole, but I would add like a couple of stuff as well, because Sunderland is a very diverse city with loads of like international students and also like you like English students from everywhere around the UK. The university staff is completely and like fully helpful. They always like supported me with any question that I had, really. I was struggling throughout looking for this placement that I am, and Sunderland Future has really helped me a lot. So it's like a great university with loads of people to help and like just really helpful people. Yeah.
Thank you, Ahmed, on that. One thing you'll be able to affiliate yourself is with our alumni society within that. You know, we have over 10,000 alumni students, and we run the guest speaker session. And as testament, the alumni students always want to stay connected with the University of Sunderland. So once again, that is a clear message that they do value their time at the university and long after they leave. I'm going to bring Drew to lead on the next question. Drew, why shouldn't international students study at the University of Sunderland?
I think, to be honest, the list is quite endless with this one. First of all, we are a university beside the beach and on the riverfront, if you're at our main city campus, which I just think is phenomenal. There's surfing facilities, all sorts of great water sports on the beach and on the sea as well, which is amazing. We also have a lot of support systems and a really friendly vibe. We're known as the friendly university, which I think people want as you come to a new country to study. Our student union, it has international officers who are there for your own very needs. And if you're based in London on our London campus, then you will also be in the thriving heart of central London as well. I think what I also want to add is that many of our courses score really highly in the National Student Survey. You're not certainly not going to be alone because there's over 100 different languages which are spoken on campus. We have international friendship group evenings on Tuesdays, worship facilities for students who need it from all different faiths and multi-faith backgrounds, as well as over 70 plus different student societies and sports teams. What's not to love about that?
Yeah, Drew, I couldn't agree more. And I particularly want to develop that point that you mentioned about our beach. I cycle along the coast each morning and I am amazed, no matter what the weather, people are swimming from 6 o'clock in the morning till early evening on an afternoon. And also, I think when students invest in the University of Sunderland, they're getting one for the price of three. As you mentioned, we've got our London campus and we've got our Hong Kong campus, and we do not operate in silo. So a lot of the assignments are connected with other campuses, either Hong Kong or London or collectively within that. But Dave, could I bring you in? Why should an international students study at the University of Sunderland?
Thank you very much, Derek. And again, a warm welcome to everybody who's tuned in and listening to this. I think a lot of this has already been said, but my take on this, Sunderland is very specifically located in the northeast of England. And northeast is, renowned for a very sort of welcoming and a very friendly vibe and culture. And Sunderland is no different. The beauty I think about Sunderland is all the great things that we've said already. It's a city, it's self-contained, it's got everything a student or anybody else would want to would need to conduct their studies and maybe settle and live their life afterwards. But it's not a massive conurbation. It's not a huge city. And that in itself really, I think, lends itself towards getting to know your way around, not getting lost too often, and just being able to find your way about and find everything you need within not too huge a geographical area. And I think that culture spins into the university as well. Many of the staff have worked and lived in the area, and we are very student friendly, as Drew says. And again, for an international student, I'm always great admiration of people who travel halfway around the world to conduct their studies. But you're not going to be lost in a sea of thousands of students. You will very, very quickly get to know your lecturers and your staff, and you won't just be a number on a spreadsheet. We'll know you by your first name. We'll get to recognise your face as you're wandering around the corridors, and we'll say hi, coupled with your personal tutor, somebody who's there to help look out for you and help steer you if you get any issues and problems. So yeah, it's that whole sort of that whole package, that whole wraparound sort of care, isn't it? Of great academic teaching, but if life throws a curveball at you, we've got some great support services and help there if you need it.
Yeah, Dave, thanks very much for that. I just want to emphasise, yes, we may not be a huge city, but we have a huge stadium and a football team. And just to mention about the football stadium, once again, we have very close ties with the Sunderland Football Club. And every summer, we have A-listed bands such as Coldplay, Rihanna. And once again, students have the opportunity to engage in live assignments in events management within that. And that's another attraction for students to come along. Moving to the next one, but I want to keep you, Dave, I want to keep you on to follow on the next question. What courses are popular for the international students? Back to you, Dean.
Yeah, I think it goes without saying that most of the courses across the university have international students on them. You know, I can appreciate, you know, what a big deal this is for people moving across the world to conduct their studies. But as soon as they get here, there are international students across all courses, and all courses are open for international students. For myself, I can speak for engineering, which is my home subject, as it were. And we've got, you know, the traditional engineering programs, such as mechanical and electrical engineering. They're very, very popular for international students, both at undergrad and at postgrad as well, and some of the more sort of contemporary digital manufacturing and things as well. But, you know, across the university, you see international students on all courses. And as a member of academic staff, I think the other thing worth noting, by joining a course at a university that is very experienced at welcoming and including international students, that brings a really rich culture into the classroom as well. So working on assignments, you know, it's not just what you will learn from the lecturing staff, but you learn from your peers as well. And you understand how some of the theories and ideas carry out in different cultures as well. So that brings a real sort of rich, diverse learning experience, I think, for everybody.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, David. Just before I bring in Drew, one of the perks I very much enjoy teaching our international students and national students is having the cookout. So our students come along and they bring a traditional dish from their home country. And so it emphasizes, it's not all about hitting the books. Mm. It's about that social interaction, finding out who you are, where you want to get in life, and the friends that you make. As I mentioned before, with the alumni, you will have friends for life within that. Drew, which courses are popular for international students?
Yeah, well, I mean, we've got a real range across the university when it comes to this. As Dave was saying about the courses earlier, there's further ones on top of that even. So, for example, we do see international students on every course, but we also have them on things like public health. We have them on our new MSc in criminology, criminal justice. We see them across our teaching degrees, wanting to become primary, secondary school teachers, and we see them on social work as well in our MA social work. But this goes across the board. Business, media, law all have high amounts of international students on them. And we do with our MSc, and I speak from my experience, our MSc Inequality in Society, where people want to tackle the nature of inequalities and how to then deal with that. So we've got all sorts of courses across the university. And I should really add that you'll not be feeling left out in this one either, because we were named as the most inclusive university in 2020, as well as being shortlisted as the best university of the year. So why wouldn't you want to come and study with us?
Drew, thank you very much for that. And one thing I want to emphasize is, because of one of the positives out of the pandemic, we were able to place students on virtual placements, and that involved mix and matching students from different programs. Doctoral programs were working with undergraduates. Undergraduates were working with postgraduates from different faculties within that. And that sharing of their interpersonal skills, they all made impact. And that's something that we're going to take forward under the Changemaker Santander project. Lee, I know you're very keen to answer this question. What does the university have with regards to new facilities?
Yes, I'm very keen to answer this question, absolutely. But can I quickly just go back to one previous comment and talk about the beach and just say that I absolutely love that we're next to the beach. I'm sorry, I'm jumping around here, but I went with colleagues the other day, saw dolphins swimming off Roker Pier. I walk down there most days from my office, which is in St. Peter's. It's about a 10-minute walk, fantastic coffee shop down there. So big up to that. So yeah, that's really nice. But we do some serious work here as well, obviously. In terms of facilities, the university is in a constant kind of program of investment in resources. So we have a new medical school and, you know, a lot of exciting resources associated with that. Lots of student-facing resources in terms of recreation and what have you. In my own faculty, over the summer, we made a major investment. So we invested in a new Northern Centre for Photography, which is a completely purpose-built photographic space with amazing resources, like, you know, just perfectly tailored for the needs of students, just fantastic space to learn. In the Media Centre, we've put in a new virtual production studio. Now, this is, if you've seen Disney's Mandalorian series, this is the technology behind that that program, where you've got virtual backgrounds with live action in front of them, as well as a fantastic new radio studio. I mean, there's so much going on, and clearly the mission of the university is to give students the best possible tools and the best possible platforms so they can succeed and they can do their best work. So it's always exciting. There's always something happening. There's always new resources going into the spaces. So by the time you arrive here, we'll have more new things to talk about. So really, really exciting. And it's a great place to be because we do make that investment.
Thanks very much, Lee. Just before I bring Ahmed, Lee, I must say the television studio is phenomenal. And I'll be using that this Wednesday once again, as state-of-the-art facilities. Very impressive. Ahmed, does the university have specific facilities to entice students to come along on campus to register?
Yeah, basically, like the university really encourages everyone to apply for everything, really. I mean, and I've looked at it since I was doing my foundation year here. Like, to start with, there were some courses that, like, maybe international students weren't allowed to do, but now it has improved, and like they are allowed to apply for it, and they do it now. So every faculty and every major really is like open for everyone at the moment. So that is another thing to add to Lee. When the students arrive here, there'll be much more opportunities for them.
Thank you very much, Ahmed. And I must say, our gym physical fitness facilities at the university are state of the art. And, you know, the students from all faculties flock to the gym to get their daily or weekly workout. Turning to the what links with industry are there at the university? So I'd like to bring in David. What links do we have with industry, David?
Thanks very much. I think this is a great question, and it follows on nicely from the facilities as well. So again, in engineering, and I know this is the same mantra across the university, but when we're looking to invest and we're looking for, be it software, be it equipment or something else, we're always looking for what is state of the art, what is industry using, and therefore what will our students be able to put on their CV to say, right, well, I've used this specific piece of software, or I've used this specific piece of kit, so that when they go to an interview, they can talk knowledgeably about that and get into a job and actually hit the ground running and be able to make an impact on that business. We've talked at length already about Sunderland being very student-centred, but also another one of our strap lines is that we are industry-facing. And that means something probably slightly different across different faculties and what industries we're engaging with. But I know that we have industry advisory boards across the university. So for engineering and the Faculty of Technology, we have a group of industry, it's a panel of industry leaders who are able to advise us on their latest thinking, what skills they're looking to recruit in the next 5 to 10 years, and how we can shape and how we can design our courses. Many of the courses across the university are accredited by professional bodies as well. That's not something that is easy to get, so we work very, very hard to work again with those industry bodies, and we work hard to maintain the standard of our course. But if you're coming on an accredited course, you can be really sure that quality of that education is really top notch, and you know, we'll stand against side an education from any university. So that's another way that we are aligned with industry, because there's certain stipulations. Again, I could talk at length for the accreditation process for engineering, but I know it's the same for all for all disciplines as well. And I think fundamentally, you know, myself, I've worked out in industry, and I know that's the same, that you know, you're coming to a university that doesn't just employ people who can kind of talk the talk. We've walked the walk as well. We've been out there, we've been in industry, and we can bring all of that wealth of experience back into the classroom, into real live examples and realistic assignment scenarios, and bring all of those little anecdotes of how to do things when you're out in industry, but sometimes how not to do them as well. And I think that's important as well, to be able to learn from that. So they're the ways I think that that the university is really aligned to industry. I'm sure the rest of the panel will have examples of their own as well.
Yeah, sure did. And I also want to emphasise that this employability exposure isn't bolted on at the end of the programme. This is very much day one, week one of the programme. And also, you point out many academics have worked in industry, but we also do a lot of consultancy across the university. So we're constantly bringing in current events, current issues, current challenges into the classroom. And it's actually the students quite often come up with the solutions in the group dynamics and different types of studying that we devolve across the programmes. Lee, what links with industry are there at the university?
Well, yeah, I mean, Dave's covered it very articulately. I mean, I think that it's a bit of a sliding scale in the sense that there are some programs, it's something to look out for when you're applying. There are some programs where there's a kind of fitness to practice kind of aspect. Like, you know, there's obviously if you in medicine, you need to qualify to be a doctor. But on that scale, you know, you've got a lot of other disciplines where there's accrediting bodies which basically give you a massive CV boost. So if you want to be a journalist, our courses in journalism are accredited by the National Council for the Training of Journalists. Not easy to say because I've just tripped over it, but it's a wordy accrediting body. Now, it's not 100% essential that you have that qualification, but I'm telling you, that's what editors are looking for. So that's what we do across the programs, is we're looking for those kind of stamps of approval on your qualification that we know will give you an advantage when you go out into the jobs market. Now, there's also sector skills bodies. So again, in media, to use examples close to home, we have Screen Skills, which is the UK film and television industry sector skills body, and they accredit some of our programs as well. So loads of examples of things like that. And the other thing I would say is we do use a lot of simulated learning. So where you're in a safe space as a student and you kind of have a go at what it would be like in industry. But as we're hinting at here, there's a lot of practice where you're actually putting yourself out there. So if you want to work on our 24/7 radio station, that is a radio station that is broadcast on FM and around the world online, subject to all the regulatory rules that apply to every, you know, the BBC, everyone who's broadcasting. So that's where you are not just kind of working with industry, but you're out there as a practitioner and subject to those same rules that apply to those people who are in the job. So, I mean, there's countless examples of this. This is what we're about as a university. If you're looking for somewhere where you're going to make connections, network, see a pathway into the roles that you want professionally, Sunderland is absolutely perfect for you.
Thanks very much, Lee. Drew, got a question here. What careers and employability opportunities are available for students?
Right, okay. Yeah, so at the University of Sunderland, there's all the kind of internal things you'll do within your course, which we've kind of touched upon a little bit. But just to go into a little bit more depth about that, I think sometimes we think of careers and employability as only something you do after the course, but in actual fact, it's something you're developing all the way through. One of the things that we do often at Sunderland is problem-based learning, where we present real-world problems for you to present real-world solutions back to us. And that's a key skill going forward. And as well as learning new software, new kit within your courses and picking that up and having that on your CV, you'll notice that all of our courses pretty much have placements built into them. And there's additional opportunities to do things depending on your course. So for example, if you're studying law, you can take part in the law clinic and help give free legal advice to members of the public. If you're in marketing, we have a marketing hub which does the same type of thing with organisations. If you're in social sciences, you may take part in social research placements in areas such as equality, human rights, and international development. So, for example, from my own experience, I've taken students out to, as part of their kind of career and employability enhancement, to Kenya and Nepal, doing international development trips, working with charities and third sector organizations out there. So there's a range of things that you can get involved with. And my big motto is always say yes to things, because you never know where you're going to end up, really. But that's just some of the stuff kind of internal to courses. External to that, and as additional support for you, we've got great pots of cash like the Silver Fund, where you can take part in a group activity based around what you cover in your course itself. So that might be you and your course buddies engaging in a everything from a writing retreat to a trip to visit a TV studio, for example, in another part of the world or part of the UK. You also have access to Sunderland Futures, who are Career Centre. They will offer you everything from internships and volunteering experience to build up that experience alongside your course, as well as the placements you may do in your course, but also things like a two-day leadership management course called Leading Lights, or offer you a mentor in actual industry who you can meet with a few times per semester to ask those really clever questions about, well, what types of things may pop up at interview? What does the sector actually look like? And have that mentorship as you go throughout your course. Alongside this, the Sunderland Futures will also offer you additional qualifications, such as our Super Award, where you can actually prove to employers the skills, experience, things you've done outside of your course to them and be awarded a professional qualification for it. But I think as a university, we offer all of our assessments as employment facing. We will give you that CV support right the way through, as well as opportunities with career fairs. And I think very importantly to this one, to maintain your journey and that guidance on the journey as you leave university, you have access to Sunderland Futures for up to 3 years after your course ends. So you can continuously go back and seek that career and employability support even after you graduate, which I just think is a great thing to have.
Drew, thank you very much indeed for that. A very thorough answer. Hamid, what careers and employability opportunities are available for students?
I want to talk about a couple of points, really. The first point is what Drew mentioned about Sunderland Futures. Basically, the placement that I am in just came through Sunderland Futures. They helped me throughout the whole process. But what I wanted to mention is that they not just give you the job. Like, I was offered, like, all of this is free of charge, obviously. I was offered the chance to improve my CV, and that by doing that, it's just sending them the job application with my CV and with work, and tailor this, like, the CV on the job application, obviously not faking anything, just working on your qualifications and try to make it look good for the job. And the second thing is, after you get the job offer, you get an opportunity to work with someone on your interview skills, and they prepare you for in the interview. All of that, again, is free of charge. So yeah, that's what Sunderland Future does. They were very helpful with me finding that placement. And I wanted to talk about the tutors as well. Like, throughout my course, the tutors would send us any job opportunity that they will have, even before they put it on their LinkedIn account or something. They email us to the student first and see if someone's interested, and if not, they put it on LinkedIn. So that's how helpful and how Uni Sunderland can help you get a job after you graduate, or throughout your 3 years or 4 years of education.
Ahmed, thank you very much, and it's worth noting to the listeners or the viewers that you strongly recommended to watch some of the videos of students who've actually been on placement, and that growth in confidence and knowing that the knowledge and skills that they are acquiring on a programme are very first rate and acceptable in the commercial arena within that. Just before I move on, Ahmed, how did your course that you're studying prepare you for your placement?
Throughout everything, really, because obviously what you study is not just obviously we study through assignments, and throughout the assignments, we did everything that covered what you do in work and stuff like that, and how you do it and stuff like that. And basically my graduation project is going to be about what I do in the placement. So that's how it's going to correlate at the end.
Okay, thank you, Ahmed. I'm going to bring in David. David, I've got a question here from Delvin from Malaysia. And Delvin's question is, will employers look upon our experience and exiting qualification as a first-class qualification in delivering employability? So Delvin's asking, do our qualifications meet the expectations of employers?
Yes, I mean, absolutely. You know, we've already talked at length about how the courses are designed and put together in, you know, in conjunction with employers, and they have that approval. Here in the UK, we've got the quality system, which kind of sits behind all of this as well. And we have you know, permission and right to award degrees. So yes, if you're, you know, given a BEng honours in engineering, for example, you know, that is an internationally recognised qualification. And, you know, there's equivalencies across the world as well. So, you know, large employers in home countries will know exactly what's contained in there as well. As academic staff as well, we're always very pleased to write references and, you know, letters to prospective employers as well to share our experiences of working with you. Because, again, coming back to my previous point, we do know our students, you know, and we get to know you through the course. And, you know, if we've supervised final year projects and dissertations and things, then, you know, we're well placed to be able to endorse your skills and your abilities. So in short, yes.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Lee and Drew with this question here. And this is from Hassan from Jordan. And so, Drew, how are we ensuring an enriched student learning experience?
Okay, so I think that comes on many levels. I think that comes from everything that we've talked about so far. It's all enrichment within itself. But I think there's enrichment in building up friendships and networks as well. And so there's a lot of support on campus for you to do that. Like I mentioned earlier about the Students' Union, that enrichment can come in through engaging with the Students' Union, sports teams, societies, fairs, all of that kind of good stuff. But I think that enrichment is also a personal thing. And knowing that you have that support too from the university in terms of health and well-being and other types of support too. Enrichment also comes obviously in placements and in other opportunities wider and external to the university, which we'll put you into contact with.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Lee?
Yeah, I mean, again, yes, we've covered so many things. I mean, that's kind of the mission for us is to give students a fantastic experience, give them the support that gives them great outcomes, so great degrees, you know, to be successful, go out and get a employment or enterprise. So it's part of the overall mission. I mean, a couple of examples I would give you of kind of enrichment activity. I've actually got a still in my background here because I can't be in, that's our media hub in the media center. I can't be in there because it's far too noisy, busy, exciting, interesting, diverse a place to do a Teams conversation in front of. So that's an example of somewhere you can go, whoever you are, whatever program you're on, to do some journalism or some writing or make some content for our radio station or our websites. Another thing that we do in the Faculty of Arts and Creative Industries, just as an example, and the kind of thing that's mirrored right across the university, is we have something called Creative Industries Week. So this is where all students come off timetable for a week. So you don't do your normal kind of workshops, lectures, whatever, it, you know, your normal studies, and you get a chance to do something completely different. So that might be, you know, a student from performing arts who wants to go in, blow some glass in the National Glass Centre, which is part of the university, or, you know, somebody who wants to try their hand at being on the radio or whatever it might be. So that's something that sits outside of your curriculum and is just meant to just broaden your horizons. We've got quite a lot of catchphrases here. I think we've been through a few of them, but one of our big ones is life changing. So the whole idea of this university experience is that we're going to change your life for the better. We're going to open up possibilities and broaden your horizons. So it's all about giving you that rich experience. So a couple of examples, but I could give you hundreds.
I'm sure you can, Lee. David, I think you would have contributed.
Yeah, it's a really interesting question about the enrichment and something I always tell my students, you know, if we had 100 people who come in and study mechanical engineering and they all leave with a first, we've got loads of examples of enrichment and how you can enhance your CV. But you've got to remember that it is your journey and it's your life that's being changed and it's your CV. So it's about picking out the things that you want to do as a student, have an idea of the areas that you want to go. And, you know, we're speaking so passionately about all the great things that are available. no one student will be able to fit all of this in, I'm sure, because there's that much. It's such a rich, you know, sort of portfolio of things. So it's about you reaching your potential and heading in your direction. And along the way, I know I can speak for engineering, and I know I can speak for any other course as well. We will also expose you to new ideas and new things that you might not have thought exploring. And some of those you'll have a look at and think, you know what, that's not for me. But other things you'll think, oh, I'd never thought of that. And I'm going to explore that a little bit further. And as Lee says, all of these things will kind of stick to you. They'll, you know, they become part of your DNA. They become part of your upbringing, your education, and you will draw on them later in life. Absolutely.
Sure. I've got a question here from Zhu from China. And Zhu says, my parents are paying for my education and we want to know, should I defer my studies until 2022, when hopefully things will be back to normal? Now, I'd like to bring in Drew on that question.
My advice would be to go for it now, to be honest. The university have returned back to, as best we can, as far as we know, face-to-face teaching, which is great. Fantastic environment, bring people back into the classroom, but also using a hybrid of online learning techniques as well to go alongside it. I think we've learned a lot from coronavirus, and I think we've all sharpened our skill sets, sharpened our toolboxes, and it's been a great opportunity to bring people back into the classroom now. So my advice would be, come now. This is a perfect opportunity. Everyone's buzzing and excited and back on campus. Come and join us.
Thank you very much, Drew. Ahmed, I'd like to bring you in from your perspective as a student. What's your message to prospective students that may be umming and erring whether to join their educational degree?
My advice, I wouldn't defer. I'll just come as soon as possible, because, like, personally, from my personal experience, joining University of Sunderland was a life-changing, like, decision. So I can't wait for someone else to change their lives by coming here. And as Drew said, we're back to face-to-face now. Everyone's excited, everyone's happy. So there's no happier days than now. And meeting a lot of people at the moment, because everyone's excited to meet a lot of people after being stuck in our own places for a year. Everyone wants to meet new people now. So yeah, just do it now.
Do it now, couldn't agree more. David, you want to contribute as well?
I would wholeheartedly agree with both Drew and Ahmed, but just picking up on one of Drew's points as well. One of the fascinating things I find is, you know, what we've been through in the last year and a half, 2 years with COVID has changed the world. It has changed the way that we work. And that hybrid way of teaching has changed the way we operate. It's sharpened our skills. But also remembering everything that we've already said on the call already about how we're trying to align our programs with the world of work. The world of work has changed as well. And that in itself is great preparation when you go out into your junior roles and post-graduation, that you will be ahead of some of your peers and your new colleagues because you're used to working in that hybrid way. So, you know, be that engineering, be it social work, be it journalism, you know, everybody's now operating in that hybrid method. And it's, you know, we're preparing students in that respect as well.
Okay. Thank you, David. Now, this is a last question, and I'm going to go and ask all the panel members this. What is life like in the northeast of England? And that is a question from Abio from Nigeria. What is life like in the northeast of England? So not just about the university, the northeast. Lee.
Quite cheap, which is good. I mean, we've touched on it before. I'm from the northeast. I've lived in other places. I've traveled around the world as a journalist, and I absolutely love it here. You know, it's a place where that is affordable. You know, with a couple of hours on a train to Edinburgh, a few hours to London, you can jump on a plane for our international airport and go anywhere in the world. I mean, I love living here. I'm going to confess, I'm a Newcastle United fan. I'm going to confess that now. And it's quite an exciting time to be a Newcastle United fan because we've just got new owners and we're very wealthy now. So a very exciting time for me, I have to be honest.
Thank you for that insightful answer there, Lee. Drew, what's life like in the Northeast?
I think for me, it's the mix of the culture and the heritage. And there's a ton of historical sites to see, whether you love castles, whether you're interested in kind of, you know, going all the way back history, from Romans to Normans, Saxons, and so on. But you've got that mix of kind of culture and heritage alongside the electricity of our cities. where on Friday and Saturday evenings, it's fun and it's partying and it's enjoyment. And there's places to eat with restaurants from all over the world. And it's a great opportunity, like I say, to kind of really become part of that. And I love the distinct mix of the two things.
Sure. Couldn't agree more as well. Ahmed, what's life like in the northeast of England?
You said that this question is from a Nigerian student, isn't it?
Yes.
So let me start by saying it's very different from what you're used to. It's like actually really nice. And like obviously, as Lee said, in the Northeast, there is the richest club in the world. So we can't argue with that. There's going to be some elite football being played in the Northeast. Also, like there's loads of like access to like loads of historical stuff. And if you're into movies, you can go to obviously Durham to check out where Harry Potter was being filmed. There's loads of stuff doing the Northeast, loads of fun stuff. I've done everything really. So yeah, it's really exciting to be here, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, sure. Thanks for that, Ahmed. David.
Yeah, again, I would agree with everything that's already been said. I think, you know, the living in the northeast of England, it's a self-contained but not too large area. You know, anything that you're into, you know, be it outdoor sports, be it culture, be it theatres, cinemas and all of that sort of thing as well. But in the context of international students, and certainly what I love about living in the UK is seeing the seasons. And, you know, we see the lovely warm days when we can go and explore the beach. We're in the middle of autumn now. We've got the leaves turning orange and falling off the trees and those crisp days. And I never, ever tire of spending time with international students who are seeing snow for the first time in the winter. It's one of the absolute perks of my job. It really is. So, you know, for a real, true life-changing experience and just experiencing a totally different culture and a different climate and things as well, you know, come along. It would be great to see you on campus.
Yeah, certainly. Panel members, Lee, David, Drew and Ahmed, thank you very much for your insightful answers there. Once again, for the listeners, if you want to ask any questions, tap on the profile and one of our ambassadors will feed back to you and make that decision. Thank you and goodbye.